treat for you this morning. Today is this weekend's a year since my wife Lisa went home to be with the Lord up there. She's having a wonderful time, a little bit envious, and amen. In that way, we're so thankful for that. And I wasn't sure if I wanted to be here today or not, but you know, I've been in front of you all year, very transparent, and I've been enjoying your blessing. And today, though, I have a friend who's here from Philadelphia, and Pastor Mark, and he wasn't able to be here last year for the memorial, but those of you who are here, he did send a song, and we played it that he sung, and so today he'll have a treat for you at the end of the service as well. But I'm so thankful that he is here. He's a good friend. He has spoken here in the past at our missions conferences. His wife spoke at the women's conference a few years ago. That we had, and we support him and his church as an inner city mission as well there in Philadelphia. And so I'm thankful that he's here, and he's going to bless you with the word. I took some good mental notes during the first service, but there's one thing I learned during the first service which really blessed me, and that is that it's a sin actually to root for the Philadelphia Eagles. I don't know if he meant that, but that's kind of how the Holy Spirit, at least, no, I'm not going to blame that on the Holy Spirit. Well, I mean, hey, y'all got to talk to the brother from Philly. You know, I don't know if he's going to say it the same way this service, but anyway, nevertheless, Pastor Mark, come on up. He's going to share with you some things about those of you who don't already know him. Obviously, many of you have seen him here before. Ms. Charlene, please stand. That's his lovely wife back there, and they've just been a blessing to me through the years, so thank you for being here.
Oh, God bless you, man. I love this guy. But I really meant the Carolina Panthers. I didn't mean the Eagles. Good to see you guys again. I think I've been here three times. I think this is my third time here. One time I came down, then second time, when Charlene spoke at the conference, I stayed that Sunday. And then, yeah, actually, this is the third time I've been. I love this church. And we get a chance. I've been in Calvary Movement about 20 years now. Yeah, my church is about 20 years old. But we get a chance, because we run inner city churches, to speak at so many different Calvaries across the country. So, which is a privilege. You know, we get to meet a lot of different churches. But this is one of my favorite churches. You know, by far. So you guys are wonderful. Amen. I appreciate you guys. And I love Kevin. I loved Lisa. And Lisa was like the joy of a party. You know, when she walked in, she just had that, the fragrance of Christ, you know. And so she's greatly missed, but she's in, again, in glory. She don't want to come back here. You know. We're coming to join you, Lisa. You know, that's what, you know, so. Let's pray. Let's get into the word. Father, thank you, Lord, for how you load us daily with benefits, Lord. You love us, Lord. You care for us, Lord. Not one of us, Lord, is your favorite. You love us all the same, Lord. And Lord, we bring nothing to the table. The table's already been set for us, Lord. And so Lord, we love to come. And you said, taste and see that the Lord is good. We do know you're good, Lord. We do know, Lord, you are perfect. We do know that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever, Lord. We do know, Lord, that you care for us because you gave your life for us, Lord. And so, Father, I pray, Lord, speak to us today, Lord. Teach us the things we don't know. And the things we do, Lord, I pray you confirm those things. Make them like an anchor to our soul, Lord, that we could experience your love towards us, Lord, and that we could bear fruit with our lives, Lord, that some could bear fruit 100-fold, some 60, some 30, Lord. And as David prayed, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. My strength and my redeemer, I do pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Amen. Good to see you guys. Look, if you have a Bible, turn to Isaiah chapter 9. We'll look at Isaiah chapter 9. When you get it, just say amen. Amen. That wasn't enough people to say it, so people start turning. So the louder the amen is, the more I know that everybody has it. So when I stop hearing this, I know people got it. And I didn't tell y'all this story in the first service, but this something interesting happened. I'll tell y'all this while y'all turning. It was a lady, and this lady, the police was traveling behind her, and she was flying, and the police comes. And it's interesting, when the police comes, he pulls her over and he says, "Miss, you've been speeding, you've been going real fast." And she had this big thermos in her hand. And he said, "What is that you're drinking?" And she looked at him. I said, "What do you mean, officer? It's water." And he snatched the thermos from her while she rolled her window down. And the officer actually tasted it. And he spit it on the ground. And he said, "That's wine." She looked at him. She said, "Praise the Lord, Jesus did it again." You know? I just thought I would share that with you just a minute. Yeah. Thought that was pretty funny. Yeah. Isaiah chapter 9. We'll look at the first 7 verses. It says, "Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed, as when at first he lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward more heavenly oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and the garments rolled in blood will be used for burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Now the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." Isaiah, you know, I love Isaiah. He's one of my favorite prophets. You know, you read about the major prophets, minor prophets. They're not less than the major prophets. They just wrote less information. So major, minor. Isaiah is an interesting prophet, you know, where if you know anything about Hebrew grammar, no one writes better Hebrew than Isaiah. In the Old Testament, if you were a Hebrew scholar and you went back to study writing styles, Isaiah has the greatest grammar. He has a broader grammar. He used about 2,186 different words. So he's really, really the prince of prophets, he was called. You know, he's married man, got 2 sons, has a wife that's a prophetess. And you know that's trouble, just to have a wife that's a prophetess, because they can just, you know. This morning I woke up, my wife looked and said, "Oh, let me see what pants he got." You know, I could just, you know, a prophetess as a wife is a real struggle for most men. Isaiah is the longest book, you know, 66 chapters, but it's not the longest book in regards to words. You know, Jeremiah is real wordy. Jeremiah is longer. Ezekiel is longer in regards to words. Isaiah is longer in regards to how many chapters that they formatted. So it's not the longest book, but it has the most chapters in the English Bible as we look at the Bible. So he's an interesting guy. You know, the New Testament, Isaiah the prophet is quoted more than any of the prophet, 85 times. Most in Matthew's gospel, he quotes from 9 times. Romans, when Paul writes to the church in Rome, he quotes from Isaiah 18 times. And some of the other books you go through, in the Revelation of Christ, 12 times. You know, John quotes from Isaiah the prophet. So he's a significant prophet in the Bible. You know, some say, okay, he is like a picture of the whole Bible, because Isaiah chapter 1 through Isaiah 39 is one section, and then Isaiah 40 through Isaiah 66 is another section, which is 27 chapters. So 39, 27 creates the number of in testaments. Old Testament, 39 chapters. New Testament, 27 chapters. So he uniquely writes in a systematic way, but sometimes he may say one verse in the present, then the next verse is in the future. And so he speaks in the first person more than any other prophet. He calls the Lord the Holy One of Israel more than any other book in the Bible. So he's really, really, you know, covers a broad, you know, part of history when he writes. You know, he goes all the way to the millennium. You know, he talks about the new heaven and new earth when you read Isaiah 66. So he's like, he covers a lot of the Bible. Onward, he's foretelling, and then he was forthtelling. So the people that he was speaking to, they heard a message, and then he's still speaking to us as we read through the book of Isaiah. Some scholars debate, they say, oh, he didn't write the whole Bible. I'm like, I don't really care about what they say. Jesus said he wrote the whole Bible. Because Jesus in John 12 quotes from Isaiah 53. So some say, well, he didn't write the second half. That's just nonsense. But he uses a lot of different names for God. You know, of course, the Holy One of Israel is, you know, most common. He calls him the Lord of Hosts. He calls him the Mighty One of Israel. He calls him the God of Jacob in Isaiah 2:3. He calls him the Branch of the Lord. He calls him the King. Of course, he calls him Emmanuel in Isaiah 7:14 when he, you know, speaking to Ahaz, about the virgin birth. So he's called Emmanuel. He's called the Great Light of the Gentiles. Of course, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He's called the Holy One. He's called the God of the Middle East. That's interesting. He's called the God of all comfort, the Righteous King, the Living God, the Angel of the Lord, the Glory of the Lord, the Omnipotent and Omniscient God, the Friend of Abraham, the Servant of the Lord, the Forgiver of Sin, the First and the Last, in Isaiah 44:6. He's called the Suffering Savior. He's called the Resurrected Redeemer, the God of the whole earth, the Anointed of the Lord. So the Avenger and Victorious Warrior, he's called all these names, but that's for us to know who God is. Because sometimes we put God in like a genie bottle or something. You know, that God is this big. And then we relegate God sometimes, or we place him like, this is how big God is based off our circumstances. But that's not who God is. He's the God of the whole world. He's huge. God is huge. He's massive. And he's good. And so we put God in this small thing. Oh, we say, all right, Lord, this is the circumstance, you know, you could probably do this and you probably can't. We almost think like God could probably do some things and he probably can't do other things. That's how we see God sometimes. You could surely, you know, help me on my job interview, but Lord, you can't cure cancer. Or Lord, you could surely do this, but Lord, you can't stop this. Lord, I really don't have no money, but there's no way you can pay my bills with me not having any money. Or, you know, we look at God based on circumstances, and that's not who God is. He's not locked into just our circumstances. He works in our circumstances, amen? So he's the God who calls those things that don't exist as though they were. That's who God is. And Isaiah understood some things about God as he writes and as he pens this. His ministry lasted for years. I mean, Isaiah says, the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. He was commissioned that year to public, more prophetic ministry. It seems that way. But he would live through, Uzziah dies, Uzziah reigned longer than in second reign, longest reign of all the kings of Judah. Of course, Manasseh was 55 years. Uzziah reigned for 52 years. But after Uzziah, his son Jotham reigned 16 years. His son Ahaz reigned 16 years. Then Ahaz's son Hezekiah reigned 29 years. Isaiah was through all those ministries. Tradition says that Manasseh had him sawn in two, so he at least reigned, if he was public, almost 60 years. That's a long time to be a prophet. And so God had raised this man up to write these things that we're still reading today. That I love the book of Isaiah. Everybody should read the book of Isaiah in 1 year. And just write down a million questions which you don't understand. and start challenging yourself, you know, and say, Lord, I want to know what he's saying here. I want to know what he's saying there. And this chapter, he goes from the present to the future, the present to the future. So this is a great chapter, and I'm only going to go through the first seven verses. So when he says, verse 1 in chapter 9, nevertheless, this is in connection with chapter 8 when Isaiah spells out the judgment and the chastening of the Lord that would befall the nation of Israel and Judah for a few things, for their sin of idolatry and immorality and just flat out disobedience to God's word. You know, just flat out disobedience to God's word. He says, nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is in distress, as when at first he lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and the Syrian army would come from the north and come through Galilee, the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, and judge Rezin. They would judge Pekah, the sons of Remaliah, and this would be known as the gloom or a dark time in Israel's history when the northern kingdom, you know, when the northern kingdom would be taken captive, 722 BC, it was because of sin. And you had 2.5 of the tribes that wanted to be on the other side of the Transjordan. They would get captured first by the Syrians. They would put hooks in, you know, they were cruel and wicked people. And he says, nevertheless, the gloom will not be, notice, upon her who is in distress, as distress, as when at first he lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterwards more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea, notice, beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles. So in the midst of all the gloom within the nation during the life of Isaiah, the prophet would see something out of this that would be good. God does that. When it looks hopeless, sometimes he'll show us one little inkling of hope that becomes like a vehement fire. You'd be like, man, good, you know. Or you go to the doctor, he says, you're going to die, but if you do this, good, the but is better than any, thank you. And this one little glimpse of hope, so Isaiah will live through the decline of the nation of Judah, God's people, and yet, in all of that, the Lord allows him to see beyond that into the future. We should thank God for that in this sense. The world we live in today is not the world we used to live in. And you need to know that. The world is much more declining in regards to immorality like never before. And social media is an instigator. It's a real instigator. You got, you know, Instagram, Facebook is old-fashioned on Facebook, and I guess you got Threads. You know, you got all these different social media outlets, but they are destroying our children, and they are making havoc out of people's image, how they should look. You see somebody with this, you know, these girls that got the size 2 shape, and they looking, anyway, wow, yeah. And you think, I'm not worth nothing. I don't look like that. Never compare yourself to that. But so the world has this moral decline like never before. Like, we've never seen these things before. Should Charlie marry Keith? We never had those questions to ask before. And so the world is gone, but the world was always messed up. That's why Jesus came. It was always messed up. Don't ever think like, oh, man, it's bad now, because we're living in it. We can see more because of the instant, you know, news you can get. Bam, you look at your phone, and it's like a little devil on the side, you know. And, you know, and it's, the world we live in is way, way different than it was when I was a kid. I'm 61. I never think I would live past 25 where I grew up at. That was a miracle. And I look back, I'm saying, we were crazy, but we wasn't that crazy. You know what I mean? And so God allows them to see, you know, the ministry and the hope of the promised Messiah. That's what Isaiah will see. You know, he's called the consolation of Israel in Luke chapter 2, verse 25. He would see through all of this stuff that they were going through. The Syrians come into power as a superpower. He would look down. He would even prophesy about Cyrus, you know, the Medes and the Persians. He you know, in Isaiah 44, 28, Isaiah 45, 1, he's seen Cyrus come to power in his prophecies. And that was passing Assyria, Babylon, past Babylon to the next, you know, nation that would come to power. He's seen a lot of things. And here the Lord says in verse 2, the people who walked in darkness, same word used in Genesis chapter 1, darkness, obscurity is the word, almost like walking in blindness, have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. Now you say, what in the world is he talking about? You know what he's talking about? You don't have to turn to this. But in Matthew's gospel, Christ tells us exactly what he's talking about. In Matthew chapter 4, it says, now when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. By the time Christ come on the scene, this is interesting. Christ comes on the scene in Isaiah day, he says they walked in darkness. By the time Christ came on the scene, they were sitting in darkness. And in our day, they laying in darkness. It was an old song in years ago. Y'all probably too young to remember this. Some of the old heads remember this. It was a group called War. They had a song called Slipping in the Darkness. And the world we live in is just laying in darkness. They walked in darkness. They were sitting in darkness when Christ came. Now the world is laying in darkness. And it's a great light. The hope is this light. It's a great light. So how do you go from walking to sitting? Easy. Easy when we are walking in the wrong direction. Going after those things that are opposite of God. So you go from, you know, some of us started off our walk with Jesus Christ. We would witness to a tree. We would tell everybody about Jesus. We would tell them about the goodness of God. We would tell them about the hope that's found in Christ. We would tell them everything. We didn't care whether we had a husband. We didn't care, you didn't care if you were single the rest of your life. You didn't care about nothing. I thought I was going to be on a mission field the rest of my life. I'm not lying. I got saved. I said, I'm going to be a missionary the rest of my life. That's what I thought. And, you live that whole life and you start saying to yourself, I can't believe God is this good to me and he saved me. You just can't believe it. And then slowly but surely you come to church. And then all at once you start looking at people. And you start comparing yourself to the wrong things. Because we who compare ourselves to ourselves are not wise. And you look around and you say, every sermon was great. Oh, praise the Lord. That man, you better take yourself down to that Calvary, man. That church is good. And the worship is off the charts. You go crazy. Then before you know, they sung Great Are You Lord last Sunday. I don't know, they same old books. I don't know, they go through the same old books. I know all the pastor's jokes. See how we decline spiritually? Because we get too familiar with the spiritual things. And a nation has sat in darkness. They walked in darkness. They lived in darkness. But they've seen, and a great light comes on the scene, and it says, you have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. Notice that. You multiply the nations, increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide spoil. So it seems to be saying that because of this light in Galilee, there's a rejoicing that takes place. Abraham rejoiced when he saw the Lord. It says in John chapter 8, verse 56, he says, Abraham rejoiced when he saw me. Where's the joy we once had for Jesus Christ? Where's that joy? Where's the joy at? Where's the joy? Look, Nehemiah 8, 10, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Where's that joy you once had? It's just like nothing moved you. Nothing moved you. Everything, the Lord is, you got your music on. You said, praise the Lord. I love the Lord. And everything was good. You know how we can be. We have that joy leaving home in the morning. You have your devotions, you're reading, you're praying, you're on your knees, tears coming down. Use me, Lord, for your glory. Use me, And going your way to work, driving, you got your Christian music on, you listen to a message, and somebody swerving in front of you. You dumb idiot, I could just do that. Just that fast. Y'all know what I'm talking about. That's why y'all laughing. Y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. And then y'all was like, Oracle, did I do that? Yeah, you did it. Absolutely. And it was you. You know, when Jesus was drawing near the descent amount of the Mount of the Olives, the whole multitude of disciples, they began to rejoice and praise God. It says, with a loud voice, for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. That's what we should be saying. Blessed, oh, thank you, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven. So Jesus would bring joy when he comes to earth. Peace on earth and goodwill to all men. He will come. And I think that so many people have lost their joy for Jesus. They have lost their joy for Jesus. They have lost it. Somewhere that something has been replaced with something else, or sorrow or something else. But so many believers have just lost their joy for the simplicity of who Jesus Christ is. And the next three verses, the word for is coming before each verse. And now Isaiah goes back to the present. Here we go in verse. This is his present time, what he sees right before him. He says, for you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. You know, the Midianites. Remember the Midianites? People forget where they came from. The Midianites were descendants of Abraham. Second wife, Keturah, in Genesis chapter 25, verse 1 and 2. He had a son named Midian, and the Midianites came through him. They were enemies of Israel, and they had the same blood flowing through their veins. They were enemies of Israel. Remember Gideon, scary old Gideon? And the angel appeared to him, said, Gideon, you mighty man of valor. He said, who, me? Yeah, you. And he fought. And, you know, God had, at first, he had 32,000 men, remember? And then the 32,000 men end up being 300. So essentially, 31,700 got sent home. And he says, now you fight the battle. 300 divided into 135,000 Midianites. That's who you're going to fight with. 300 soldiers against 135,000. You do the math. That's 450-1. Now God says, now you go fight. And it says in Judges chapter 8, they were chasing the enemy. They were exhausted, still chasing the enemy. It didn't say that the enemy was chasing them. And they won the battle. 300 men. The Midianites. But in this verse, no doubt this yoke of oppression was that of the Assyrians, and it would be broken as in the days of Midian when God would, remember the Assyrians, they surrounded Jerusalem? When Hezekiah and Isaiah, they go pray together, and they go in 2 Chronicles chapter 32, verse 20, they go and pray in the house of the Lord together. Rabshakeh, one of the delegates and envoys for the Syrian army, was talking all this smack over the wall, and he said, please don't speak in Hebrew, and he kept talking all this stuff. But remember when God sent that one angel, we don't know his name, it could have been Woodrow or Tito, we don't know. But we know God sent one angel and destroyed 185,000 Assyrians in one night. Remember that story? And so that's what Isaiah is alluding to in that sense. And that king Sennacherib, because they kept saying, thus said Sennacherib. That's a problem within itself. Thus said the king of Assyria, Sennacherib. Thus says a man. It's only thus says the Lord. But remember, it says that he walked away and left, went back shamefaced, the Bible says. And he went back and worshiped his god, Nisroch, in his place. And his two sons came. One of his sons' name was Adram Melech, and the other one's name, Shariza. They struck their own dad and killed him. And then their other brother, Ashurhatan, came and ruled in his place over the nation of Assyria. And then essentially, by the time 612 B.C. gets here, the book of, you read about the book of Nahum, that's the destruction of Assyria, and the Babylonians come to power in 612 B.C. And so this is, Isaiah saw that. And then he says, for every warrior's sandal, from the noisy battle, noises a sense of confusion, and garments rolled in blood will be used, notice, for burning and fuel of fire. There will be a day coming that God will put an end to war. Only when Christ rules and reigns. You ever wondered why, like, nations, when, you know, when you look at the news, I don't really look at the news. I don't like the news because it's bad news. I like good news. But when they say that, you know, this nation has nuclear capacity, do you think they just have that because they want to just say that? One day that stuff's going to be used. But when Christ come, Isaiah was saying in Isaiah 2:4, Micah says the exact same thing. If you read those verses, Micah 4:3, Isaiah 2:4, it says they will learn war no more. But that's only when Jesus is reigning from Jerusalem, and we are reigning with him. We'll be reigning with the Lord. You know, one day you're going to get a glorified body. I'll have my bush back that I had once. You know, all these, I'm just thinking, you know, how that might look. I don't know. I think so. I'll have some of those things back. Aren't you excited? No more Jenny Craig, none of that stuff, you know. No more treadmills and all that. Just thank God. Amen. And he says that they will learn war no more. And their garments rolled in blood will be used for burning and fuel a fire. And then he goes right into this, for unto us. And he includes himself because he says, us. He didn't say this child would, you know, would be like just any old child. He says, unto us a child is born. The child is usually capitalizing your Bible. Unto us a son is given, not a girl. Her name wasn't Jessica. His name is Jesus. And the government will be upon his shoulder. Notice singular. It doesn't say shoulders. And his, most people miss this one part. And his name, it seemed like it would say names with an S, but it says, and his name, singular, not plural, his name will be called, not might be called, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor. Notice, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Prince of Peace. Isaiah also said that he would be born of a virgin in Isaiah 7:14. Could you imagine coming home and telling your boyfriend, you're engaged, oh, I'm pregnant. I ain't never touched you, girl. This is of the Holy Spirit. You can see that banjo going, ka-gloong, you know. He says, that's funny, isn't it? Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. In verse 2 of this chapter, he says the people saw a great light, and that light would be the light of the world, Jesus Christ. The light of the world. But now Isaiah tells us again that this Messiah would be a child, for unto us a child is born. This would have never been what the world would expect it, a child born, especially the Jews in the first century. They wanted somebody to rescue them from Roman oppression, from all the Neros, you know, and all the, you know, Claudiuses and all those kind of Roman emperors. They wanted to be rescued from Roman oppression. And they wanted a Messiah that would rule and reign and have victory over their enemy. That's what they wanted. To a Jew, they don't see the Messiah as the Son of God. They see him as a man that will set things in order, not the Son of God being deity and being incarnate. They don't see him like that. For unto us a child is born. Notice he says us, he includes himself. This child was born. Why was Jesus born? You know, well, people say, I don't believe in Jesus. You know, I don't got to take a class in apologetics. No, you got a Bible. You got enough to stand and defend the truth. Why was Jesus born? Why in the world was Jesus born? You know, people say, well, Jesus, I'm a Christian. That's all you follow that Jesus. Why was he born then? He was born because the Bible says, and she shall bring forth a son. That Mary will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, and this is why he came. And he will save the people from their sins. We had a sin problem. We were separated from God. Christ became the propitious one. In other words, his blood was the only sacrifice that could appease the wrath of Almighty God for the sin of the world. We had a debt we couldn't pay. He paid a debt he didn't owe, but he paid it anyway, so we could have a way in and have access to God. Christ in his day grew up among his peers as like a tender plant, as it says in Isaiah 53:2. He would grow up, and could you imagine having a perfect brother? Well, Mr. Goody Two Sandals, you know. Could you imagine that, having a perfect brother? Just having a perfect brother. You trying to play hide and go seek? He's, I see you since the foundation of the world. I knew you was going to be at that rock, and I know what the rock is made of. You know, imagine having a brother like that. That would be hard. You know, that's why they didn't believe that. Nah, he's not no Messiah. Yeah, it says he appeared to James, the 12, and James. He's not talking about James, John brother, the Zebedee brother. He's talking about James, his brother. Joseph and Mary's son, he appeared to him, and I'm sure James would have said the same thing Thomas says, my Lord and my God, when he saw him. You know, and it's interesting, he says that this is, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. He tells us the gender of this Messiah. A son is given, and this is a gift, and it donates preexistence. Because in Galatians, Paul said that, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Because I always thought, why couldn't Jesus have come this century? Why do you have to come in the first century? But he's here. He's living through our hearts in the person of the Holy Spirit. A son is given. And thanks be to God, Paul says, for his indescribable gift. Y'all know this because you get those Christmas cards. It says, wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. But there's some depth to this. A son is given. How was he given? The cross. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through his son the world might be saved. The world might be saved. Look, men love darkness rather than light. Men love darkness. When I was a sinner, I loved sin. It was because I was a sinner by nature. I loved sin. You couldn't pull me away from sin. Where would you rather go, to church with your mom as a teenager or to the party? Party. We didn't choose nothing spiritual, none of us. It's almost like you driving somewhere. None of us, if somebody tried to run us off the road, said, the Lord ain't doing nothing but sanctify me. None of us. We go to the other extreme. And here Christ comes into the world, a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. Didn't say shoulders, shoulder. And his name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So he's a wonderful counselor. These are natural and divine pairs. Wonderful counselor that goes together. Jesus is a wonder. You think he's a wonder? Wonderful, merciful Savior. Remember that song, Precious Redeemer and Friend? Who would ever thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of man? You know, here we go. Wonderful Counselor, his word is our counsel. The word of God is our counsel. You know, people go try to get all this counsel. Well, I just had to go see the psychologist and I had to go see the psychotherapist. You might have to go see that sometime, but the word of God is our counsel. The word of God. The word of God, the entirety of his word is truth. The entirety of it, it's settled. The Bible says his word is settled in heaven. How can a young man or a young woman cleanse their way except by taking heed to the word of God, the word that I've hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against thee? That's his counsel. It's found right here in this book. You read this book, it'll fix you right on up. It'll help you with selfishness, self-centeredness, self-esteem. So all the words that say self that's not in the Bible. Self-image, all those things. You know, I hate to see people sometimes that you grew up with 10, 20 years ago. They be, man, you sure got big. I said, I wouldn't look the same when I was in the 10th grade. That's crazy. You know, one little thing can set you off that you could care, and it can set you off. Y'all know that. And you go and start looking in the mirror and go, oh, I need to go back to Jenny Craig. I need to start. No, no, no. God loves us the way we are. Amen. And don't you ever forget that. And his word shows that God does not look at the outer appearance. He looks at the heart. That's what the Bible says. You can fix this thing up. You can tuck it up. You can mop it up. You can pin it up. But one day it's all going in the sand in the ground. And then it'll be raised up. And that's the one you want, the raised up body. Amen. Oh, I'm sure looking old. You're supposed to. You got older. Isn't that weird? People say, oh, you look old now. Really? Jeez, I'm supposed to look 12 at 90, you know? So he's a wonderful counselor. Sorry about that, John. Mighty God. So if he's a mighty God, almighty God is El Shaddai. Mighty God means he has power. He has all authority has been given to me on heaven and earth. All authority, exousia, all power has been given to me. And this refers to deity. The word mighty could suggest hero, not Marvel heroes or superheroes in that sense, but hero. Jesus is my hero. Jesus is my hero, not Superman, not Batman. Not Spider-Man or Thor or something. You know, no, Jesus is my hero. And it says he's mighty God, everlasting Father. You know, eternal God is El Elam in the Hebrew. He's eternal. It says he's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the same yesterday, today, and what? And forever. So he changes not. In fact, he's immutable. Our God is immutable. He changes not. Don't think God is going to change up on you because you made some bad decision or mistake or did something that you didn't really desire to do, but you did it anyway. The things I want to do, I don't find myself doing. Or the things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. The things I want to do, I don't do. Oh, wretched man that I'm a wretched man that always want to do something that is contrary to God. All of us. None of us have a natural inclination to obey God. It's the Spirit of Christ that lives in us, that compels us to obey Christ, and is in a gentle, loving way. He don't make us do anything. He won't make you do anything. That's why he says, I stand at the door and knock. If you let me in, I'll come in and dine with you. He didn't kick the door down. He made the door. He was the carpenter. He says, I am the door. And he got a knock on the own door that he made. Isn't that something? You own your house and you don't even have the key to get in. Your kid's saying, well, what's the password? You know. Isn't that crazy? That's amazing to me. So he's all powerful. He's all powerful. You know, Jesus, look, if you see me, you've seen the Father. They said, show us the Father. If you see me in John 14:9, you've seen the Father. He says, I am the exegesis of the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You say, really? Yeah, you've seen. Look, every tenderness, every loving moment, every miracle that I did, I only do what the Father tells me. If you see me, you've seen the Father. We're distinct, but if you see me, you've seen the Father. And he says, me and the Father are one. And so whatever we think God the Father is, you look at the life of Jesus Christ and has lived out through Christ. And there's nowhere in the world you can leave, you know, out of church. I mean, you can come to church and leave kind of where you come in sometime, you know, depends. But there's nowhere in the world to me you could be at a Calvary Chapel. Kevin teaches the Bible. I know he teaches the Bible. And leave out of here on a Sunday and be the same. Somewhere God is speaking to you because of the Bible. He speaks through his word. We don't have no wisdom. I know I don't have any wisdom. Kevin may have some, but I don't have none. I'm telling you. I know, like, if I didn't rely on this Bible, I don't have any hope. I don't. I really don't. But I do know that he speaks to us through his word. And if you open to God's word, he'll change you. He'll change you by who he is. He'll show you how much he really loves you. The people in the world, most people in the world, lack the understanding of how much God really loves them. Because then we start looking for human love. Well, if that guy loved me, I would be all right. And, oh, I wish he could, you know, if my wife just cared a little more. If this had loved me more. And, you know, I grew up really angry because my father never hugged me. You know? No. We're new creations in Christ. We have a new government, a new economy. We live through the eyes and the lenses of the Bible and through Jesus Christ and who he is to us. Whole different life. He's powerful. I had a friend of mine said, "Lord, man, the Lord saved you. He must have said the angels must have been working overtime." I said, "I don't know about that, but I know the day when I got saved, my life was a mess. I know that much. And a mess don't always mean that you on drugs or you this or that. A mess means that you think you're something that you're not, Are you filled with pride? Are you filled with all these accolades of education, degrees behind your name, and all this? You could be a mess and have everything that the world would desire and still be a mess. And then the mighty God, the everlasting Father, his power comes and then he breaks that heart of stone. You know, it's almost like the word of God, Jeremiah 23 said, the word of God is a hammer. And he chisels away that the hardest of hearts and tells you the big guys. I remember this big guy one day. This dude was tall. He was like six, about this brother's size, tall. I mean, dialect. When he walked in, I said, man, mess with me now. I said, I'm going, tall. And this guy was sitting on the bleachers. I never forget this. He had on sunglasses. It was a day like this with overcast. And the Holy Spirit clearly said, you go tell him about Jesus. And I said, I'm not going to do it. And I went back and forth with this guy. I was going, you take two steps forward and you're going like this, you're all star moonwalking backwards. By the time I got to that guy, I was like 5 or 6 minutes in. And I lost my voice. I said, you want to hear about Jesus? He said, speak up, man. What are you talking? And he prayed to receive Christ right there. And I didn't pray with my eyes closed. I kept looking at him. I was like, no. And he had my hand. And I said, look how God can, the power of God can break through all the things. He is an everlasting Father. He's a mighty God. He has power. He's a mighty God. And we sometimes think, is just he going to do little things? No, he want to do great things in our lives. He's called Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. How many of y'all want peace? Raise your hand. I asked him the first service. All of us want peace. Especially if you got kids. They're going away for the weekend. Praise the Lord. And the kids say, Mom, we don't want to leave. You say, you're getting out of here. You know how the kids want to stay. They're crying. I don't want to go over Grandma. You're going over Grandma. You say, why? I want peace. Don't you love me? Yeah, I want you out of here, though. Kids are funny, though. They don't want to leave you when you want them to leave. Bye. I'm going away to college. How far? Great. Prince of Peace. Christ is our peace. Ephesians 2:14, he is our peace. Jesus said, these things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. Because in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. He says, I've overcome the world. Isn't that amazing? He is our peace. The only time the world's going to have peace is when the millennium kingdom is set up. Christ come back and reign. We'll reign with him. That's the only way there will ever be peace. The Antichrist will proclaim peace and almost have a peace treaty. A 7-year peace treaty, Daniel said. And 3.5 years in, he's going to renege on that treaty and want to be worshipped himself. But Christ will bring peace. He's the only peace, and we'll be in that peace. Isn't that amazing? I love peace. I love peace. Isaiah said, my people would dwell in a peaceful habitation and secure dwellings in quiet and resting places. In Isaiah 32, verse 18, my people. And here it goes. It says in verse 7, of the increase of his government, since the government will be upon his shoulders, is of the increase of his government, not our government, the United States democracy. Or what are you? Who did you vote for last year? Who did you vote? Jesus is not voted in. Praise the Lord for that. Amen? Amen. Thank you. Of the increase of his government, notice, and peace, because he's going to have a peaceful government, there will be no end. So he won't do 8 years or 4 years and have another term and everybody voted him in and all. None of that's going to happen. This is the Messiah Isaiah saw. He says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will be the final king and the only eternal king. Paul, when he writes Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, verse 15, Paul tells Timothy, he says, let me tell you something. He who is the blessed potentate, he's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. His government is the best government. Look, the government that don't let Jesus rule and reign is always going to be messed up. The only government that works is the one that Christ was set up, not the government that we vote for. You get Christians, even in the church, well, what you believe in? I'm a Democrat, I'm a Republican. None of that stuff going to matter. In the kingdom age, it's one king. And you didn't vote for him. It says, and upon the throne of David, there will be no end, but it's upon the throne of David and over his kingdom. Now, remember, David had a covenant with God. God made the covenant, not David. That God told David, when your days are fulfilled and you rest with your father, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. That's not Solomon. Solomon king wasn't forever. His kingdom wasn't forever. We know it's not Solomon. He's talking about Christ. Someone that would come through his own loins, his own descent, somewhere that would come, his ancestry would be Jesus from the tribe of Judah. That's who would be the king forever and ever. I like that because in Ephesians 2:7, it says, and to the ages to come, we will learn of who Jesus is. The ages to come, the vastness of God, the internality of God, that all out through eternity, we'll learn who Jesus is. In heaven, he'll still have those nail prints. We'll know who he is, the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. And his government won't fail like the failing governments of the world. We know he's not talking about Solomon. Remember when Gabriel came to Mary in Nazareth, this young peasant girl. Gabriel comes and tells Mary, he says that, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Aren't you glad about that? We get to heaven, it ain't no end. We're there forever and ever and ever. Isn't that something? You know, Paul would say, I have not seen, ear have not heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But by his spirit, they've been revealed to us. That's a reproach against the unbelieving world. That's something we have the world don't have. So of his increase of his government and peace, there will be no end, and upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, it says, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. The word zeal is the same word for jealousy. You know, God has a name for a jealous God. It's in the book of Joshua. It's known as Elkanah. God is not jealous like people is jealous in that sense. God wants to be first, period. And anything else first, he becomes Elkanah. He's a jealous God in that sense. Because he knows anything that's before him becomes idolatry. And it's putting him first. And anything you trust in apart from God, you'll never experience him being, you know, the wonderful counselor, you know, the mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. You'll never experience that. Because you'll think you'll find it in a human being. You won't find that. You see girls, they say, okay, well, I want a husband. They get a husband a year in. It ain't working. Well, what happened? I don't want him. Why you don't want him? Is there something ain't right? But you just told me 2 years ago he was chosen for you from the foundation of the world when y'all met. See, we want certain things, and when we get it, we say, no, I don't want that. I didn't know how to clean his underwear, and he snore, he fart every night. I don't like him. You know, and we ask for things sometimes from the Lord that later on we don't want him. Lady told me one day, I got a job. I prayed for this job. She said, I prayed for this. I was on my knee, fasting and praying. Pastor, I was fasting and praying, and the Lord spoke to me. Yeah, he touched me, and he gave me that job. And she came in praising the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm so blessed. And I said, well, how's the job going? I quit that old place. None of y'all never did that. I guess I'm probably the only guilty person. No, we do that. To learn God is to hear him carefully. And before you do anything, if you don't know what to do, you wait and don't do nothing. It says, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, Or you just take Psalm 46:10 and says, be still and know that I'm God. And that's the safe place. So Lord, I don't want to mess this up. I don't want to mess this up. You are my counselor. You are my comfort. You are my mighty God. I know all the things you tell me, but Lord, I want to stay right where you are. I don't want to front slide, and I don't want to backslide. I want to walk right in rhythm with the Lord. And something happens when it happens. Something happens. You start seeing all these names that they call him. You're like, oh, he is the everlasting. I see God doing this. I see God doing that. I see. And, you know, you can pray. Your prayer life sometime can almost, you know, as you're sitting and you're reading and you're praying, you can almost say, Lord, I know this is going to bless you if I do this. If I know it, if I'm doing it your way, I know it's going to bless you. Not bless me as much as I want to bless you. And that's what we should be praying. Lord, how can I bless you? And that changes everything. Not what I'm getting out of it, Lord. What are you going to get out of it? What are you going to get out of it? And when you start realizing that you grow in maturity, you say, no, he is an everlasting God. Oh, no, he all powerful. No, his word is my counsel. Oh, no, all the peace that I've ever had in my whole life was because of Jesus. You know, it's be anxious for nothing in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, making your request known to God. And the peace of God that surpasses all knowledge will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. That's because of Jesus I have peace. All of it comes together. It's like bookmarked in, you know? And you start saying, no, I'm not perfect. Spurgeon said, I'm not what I used to be. I'm not, you know, what I want to be, but I'm not yet what I'm going to be. But I know that I'm on the right path. I know that, Lord, here I am, Lord. I don't bring nothing to the table. It's already set. Lord, I trust your word. And Isaiah would see this child born, you know, in the sense of like through prophetically, he would see it. And the Spirit of God has him pen this for us. For unto us a child is born. A son is given. God has been given for us. He loves us. He sent his son to die in our place. Why wouldn't we want to serve him? We served everything else. Why wouldn't we should be at Bible study? We should be at prayer. We should be at, you know, church. We should, you know, why wouldn't we want to do those things? The world is cruel out there. You know, you get saved. When I first got saved, I would come to church every day. And I would get mad because it was closed on Thursdays or something. I was like, man, I wanted to be at church every day. I'm still at church every day now. But I wanted to be at church every day. I'm telling you, because I knew how cruel and evil the world is. And I know how the enemy tries to trick us up to see God the wrong way. I know that. I understand that. Do I win the battle every day? Absolutely not. But I win most of the time. And I realize who the devil is. But I know that greater that's he that's in me than he that's in the world. So don't leave out here today not knowing who God is. Look, he's wonderful. You Christmas, you know what you do? You get big box and you get a bunch of Bibles and you go to your family members. You get them a gift, though. Don't be cheap. Get them a gift and then bring out a nice Bible. Say, ta-da, Jesus loves you and he wants to save you. He loves you and he wants to save you. We had a bunch of homeless men with us yesterday. And I was like kind of, we shared the gospel with them before we could do anything. But I was looking at these guys carefully and I said, you know, some of these guys don't even know God will use them to the max. And we had a video of a guy at our church that was homeless, and he got up there. Something he said that stuck with me. He says, don't quit. He says, I am what I am because of Jesus Christ. And we are what we are is because of Jesus Christ. It's God's grace. Remember what Paul wrote Titus, and I'll close with this. Paul wrote Titus and said, look, the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, that we can live soberly and righteously and godly in this present age. And this is the reason why. Because we're looking for that blessed hope, which is the rapture, the second coming, that glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. That's the word of God. Grace is our teacher. You're here for good works. Maintain good works. Do good works. But love Jesus. love Jesus, and you have the best Christmas ever. It won't be a day, every day it'll be like Christmas. Every day will be a Christ day. Every day will be governed by God. How many of y'all think y'all can do that? We can do that. We can do that, can't we? We can say, no, we know who God is. The devil ain't fooling me. I know he loves me. Oh, the God just quit you. So what? Go ahead, Buster. I need you anyway. And yeah, God is good. And you see so many broken people because of relationships. The greatest relationship is on the vertical, not the horizontal. That Jesus loves me. Kids got better theology than some of us. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Yes, Jesus loved me. Do you know that Jesus loved you this morning, this afternoon? Do you really realize that? That Jesus loves you. And he's never going to stop loving you. Never going to stop loving you. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your grace, Lord. Thank you for being our hero, Lord. You're the one, Lord, who bled out for us, Lord. Our great high priest, Lord, you laid down your life for us, Lord. Willingly, Lord, no one laid it down for you. You laid it down willingly, Lord. You had the power to take it up again, Lord. Thank you for the resurrected power of Christ, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. It lives right through us. Lord, keep us, Lord. Keep this church, Lord, with its heart stayed on you, Lord. Raise up people that will serve you, Lord, for clear conscience, Lord. That would put their hands to the plow and never look back. That this church would never lack anything, Lord. Everything that it needs, Lord. Spiritually, Lord. Lord, physically, Lord, and financially. And every aspect and every need of this church, Lord. Supply it, Lord. And raise up even more people who would come. That they won't have room enough to receive them, Lord. And when they go into that new building, there'll just be so many people waiting outside to get to church. Wondering what's going on inside of a place where God's people had gathered, Lord. Let us be like those in the book of Nehemiah. We worship you so loud that the enemy hears us from afar. Lord, bless the people here, Lord. Bless all that you put their hands to, Lord. Bless Kevin, Lord. Keep him. His daughter, his son, Lord. Thank you for the testimony he's been here, Lord. Man that loves your word, Lord. Put a hedge around him, Lord Jesus. Wouldn't keep everybody here, Lord. Keep us all healthy that we could serve you, Lord. Lord, you said when Israel left Egypt, not one was feeble. We know you're capable of doing that too, Lord. Okay, what the world said, we know you can do it. Heal our bodies, Lord, and our physical frame that we can love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We'll use our strength for the things of Christ. We love you, we honor you, we praise you. In Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. Amen. Let's stand up. I'm going to sing a song for y'all. I got a little song. Then the worship team, I guess, to come on up. How many of y'all want to draw near to the Lord in 2024? Huh? This is my prayer. I have a prayer. Like Cornelius just said, he had a prayer. This is my prayer, that I always draw closer to the Lord. Jesus, draw me close, closer, Lord, to you.
let the world around me fade away. Jesus, draw me close, close, Lord, to you. For I desire to worship and obey. Jesus, draw me close, close, Lord, to you. Let the world around fade away. Jesus, draw me close, close, Lord, to you. For I desire to worship and obey. Jesus, draw me close, close, Lord, to you. Let the world around me fade away. Jesus, draw me close, close, Lord, to you. For I desire to worship and obey. Oh, Lord, yes, I do. For I desire to worship and obey.
God bless you guys.